Hi everyone and welcome back to my channel. I'm Jan Emes and in this video I'll show you an astrophotography shootout with the Whirlpool Galaxy. This was my first Galaxy that I imaged using my setup, my Skywatcher Ed80, my EQM35 Pro go-to mount from Skywatcher and my Nikon D7200 crop sensor camera. Tonight I will use also an auto guider and I will not use the reducer corrector for this. I have the reducer corrector here, but I do want to use at 600mm focal length to get the full focal length of my telescope and get more details from the Whirlpool Galaxy. I do want to show you comparison using the same telescope, the same mount, but only with a different camera, a full frame camera, Nikon D750. Let's see what equipment Jim is using. Hey Jim.
Hi, I'm Jim. I've been doing astrophotography now for a couple of months. And with the help of John, I've really come on leaps and bounds in my astrophotography. Like John, I also use Skywatcher ATED, the corrector. The only sort of difference is I shoot a full frame Nikon, where John shoots a crop frame. So here's my setup. Skywatcher ATED. With the Skywatcher 80ED focal reducer corrector. And I also shoot a full frame Nikon D750, which is 24.3 megapixels. Extremely low noise and great for video and also for stills imagery. I use the Skywatcher 35 EQM Pro. And then for guiding, I have my SV Bunny 50mm guide scope that has a focal length of 190mm. So the purpose of this video is about the differences in between those two setups and how that can impact your images. I'll hand you over to John.
Thank you Jim for showing your equipment and what you use for the Whirlpool Galaxy. Do not be afraid to use a crop sensor camera, they are very good for astrophotography. I got very good results with mine and it is a stock camera, it is not modified. No filter, so I am not using any filter for this Galaxy 50mm extension tube, and I have my T2 Nikon bayonet ring connected to a T2 adapter. So let's see how I photograph the Whirlpool Galaxy using my Nikon D7200, my crop sensor DSLR and my Skywatcher ED80 at 600mm focal length. I'm ready to start the plan for the Whirlpool Galaxy. But first I'll show you how I will check my focus using a backed-in-off mask. So you can see there are some spikes there. I need the center spike in the middle. It looks good, but I will try and play a little with the microfocuser just to be sure. Now I've focused and I'm ready to go to Whirlpool Galaxy. I'll go here M51 and enter. I open PhD2 and I connected the equipment, I connected the camera and the mount, and I started the looping option. So we have the Whirlpool Galaxy here, 30 seconds exposure with my Zwo Asi120mm-S monochrome camera. I saved the image, I also cleared the previous calibration and had to wait a little bit longer. So I've selected a star and after that I started guiding. We can see here on the left a small error, 0.65 arc seconds. Also enabled dithering. Now in a astrophotography program tool I will take a test shot.
Exposure started.
2 minutes ISO 1600. We can see here live at 1 second the Whirlpool Galaxy. It's very, very sensitive the camera. And the guide scope is about F4. Okay, so the signal to noise ratio was not very good, 21.4. Let's see the first image. It looks good. The stars look round. This is the first photo. This was the test shot and now I began a plan of 100 images. I could not image so much because of the clouds. So let's take a look a little bit later. I finished the plan for tonight. Unfortunately, I did have a lot of clouds. I think I will have 1 hour of total integration. I'm not sure. Now I'm taking some flat frames using my Yognuo lamp.
then I will take maybe 25 dark frames. The sun will rise in 1 hour, so I have to hurry. So I finished the plan, finished also the calibration frames, stayed all night. Unfortunately, because of the clouds, instead of 3 hours, I think I got only 1 hour of total integration on the Whirlpool Galaxy. It's a beautiful morning, the clouds went away. So here is the equipment used for the Whirlpool Galaxy. Last year I did not have the autoguider. I had, I think, exposures of 1 minute. This mount combined with an autoguider, it can allow you to image very long exposure times. I've imaged even 10 minutes. I didn't try more because I'm using my DSLR, so I do not want to have too much noise. So here we have the stacked image and edited of the Whirlpool Galaxy. I do like the details that I was able to get in 46 minutes integration time. Now let's move on the next part of the video. Okay, so I did not pass the meridian yet, so I'll have to skip and try a little bit later. I'll press ESC and I'll go back. And I'll check also the focus again, because I moved more the telescope. And then I'll wait a little bit more and I will find the Whirlpool Galaxy. I did have to wait more time until my mount made the meridian flip. Okay, so let's see in Stellarium the position of the Whirlpool Galaxy. So I searched M51, it did found it, and I did have this on, the option for equatorial mount. I clicked on the azimuthal grid. And we can see now it is on the west part. So I had to wait until it passed the meridian to be able to image the Whirlpool Galaxy. So the meridian is a line from south to north and passes through zenith, and we can see clearly here the position. It is now on the west side, but I should have been able to do this faster. Unfortunately, I had to wait more. I also moved to arcade and focus, and doing this made the meridian flip. Then after a few tries remaining on the west, it also switched to the Whirlpool Galaxy M51. So using Stellarium is very helpful. If you do want to image an object, you should also search for it and see when you have to do the meridian flip. This will help you plan your imaging sessions better. Now let's go in my garden and see how I image the Whirlpool Galaxy. Okay, so now it's making a meridian flip, it's going west. So this is what I want, to not make a meridian flip after, and start good. Point it on west. Seems in the second night I did have problems with the clouds also. If we look on the live view from my guiding camera in PhD2, we can see that a lot of clouds and the signal to noise ratio was not great. So you see the signal to noise ratio dropped to 16. We have a lot of clouds here in live view from my ZWO camera. And I also use dithering that helped me remove more of the noise and get more color and better image quality in the final stacked image. Using the images from the first night and second night, I managed to gather 90 minutes of total exposure time. And the Whirlpool Galaxy was at zenith, having two dew heaters. It created some issues. Balancing needs to be very good. I did not balance using the two dew heaters. I had to take one dew heater out and use only one on my telescope. I did try to change also the balancing from east to be more heavy on the west side, but it did work worse than before. So I had the mount a little heavier on the east, but not much. Okay. So in the imaging battle for the Whirlpool Galaxy, I will use a crop sensor camera and my ZWO120 monochrome camera. I also edited the image that Jim sent me that he made using Nikon D750. So we'll compare the results
from these three cameras on the Whirlpool Galaxy using the same telescope.
After two nights, I managed to get 90 minutes of total exposure, and let's see also the final image that I've edited after I stacked all the images together in Deep Sky Stacker. Okay, so you can see a lot of details, even with clouds. Using dithering really helped, and having 90 minutes of total integration gave me some beautiful results at 600 millimeters focal length. Let's compare this image with the image that Jim sent me. Thank you, Jim, for sending me your stack for this video. We have here the two images side by side. Here we have the image that I took with my Nikon D7200 crop sensor camera, and here the image that my friend Jim took with his full-frame camera Nikon D750. So there are not big differences between the two images. It is very hard to select a winner between the two if you do not zoom in or select the crop images. And now we have the images side by side cropped. You can see better and decide which one you like more. So we have here the image that Jim took, and I edited similar with mine with the Nikon D750, a full frame camera. So looking here also on the second nucleus, you can see much more details than here. It is softer, less noise, but also less details also in the arms. Let's check the arms. We can see more details in the arms, the spiral arms, and here between them. But a little bit noise. This noise will not be noticeable on print, and it will show more details. So now we have them side by side. You can see here lack of details and much more details here in the core. I did try to edit them very close to be very similar. It was not perfect, but good enough to be able to compare. So you can see here details are missing, and here we have much, much more detail. So side by side, zoomed in, you can see clear that the winner on details is the one that I took with the crop sensor. I did have the advantage of not using the reducer corrector. You can get beautiful images with galaxies using a small refractor like the Skywatcher ED80, and the reducer corrector, if you have a galaxy like the Whirlpool Galaxy, smaller in the field of view, do not use the reducer corrector. You see, you have it here, the ED80 reducer corrector. On my comparison, I've noticed the one that I took with my crop sensor camera, Nikon D7200, had better details. Also, I had 90 millimeters extra focal length. This also helped. So the conclusion is this, using a small refractor, do not use a reducer corrector for galaxies, except Andromeda galaxy. So if the galaxy is small in the field of view, you should use all the focal length, so you'll get more details from the galaxy that you decided to image. I also did use dithering. Last year I did not. I do have a little more, also a little more noise in the image, but also more detail than in this one. Okay, and this, the 2 hours stack that I took first year, it has less details than the 90 minute stack that I took using dithering. I do have 2 hours integration, and I used also the reducer corrector. So let's compare this with the image that Jim took. So you can see they are similar without using the reducer corrector. Let's zoom a little bit on both images. This is the one that Jim took with the reducer corrector. This is the one that I took with the reducer corrector. I definitely say this is the winner that I took this year using dithering, not using the corrector. So having 600 millimeters instead of 510 millimeters really allowed me to get extra details. Also, the resolution was better on arc seconds per pixel. You can find how your camera sensor will perform with a telescope using astronomy tools and Stellarium. Let's check now the CCD suitability using astronomy tools. You can calculate to see the resolution that you are using with your camera sensor and telescope. It is best to have a resolution between 0.67 and 2 arc seconds per pixel. Undersampling means you have less pixels than needed to capture the resolution that the telescope provides. And oversampling means the light is spread over more pixels than needed to achieve full resolution, and this also will increase your imaging time. So this is important because if you want to buy a new camera for a telescope or a telescope for a camera, it is good to know if that camera with that telescope will give you undersampled images or oversampled. So we have here 3.9 pixel size. This is the pixel size of my Nikon D7200 at 600 millimeters focal length. We have the resolution 1.34 per pixel. I'm on the sweet spot between 0.67 and 2 arc seconds per pixel. Here we have the Nikon D750 full frame camera with the pixel size around 5.95 microns. The resolution is 2.05. At 510, you'll get less details, so it is slightly undersampled. In this case, with the Whirlpool Galaxy, using the full frame camera, it would have been better a telescope with a longer focal length. At 600 is still okay, but if you go below, like Jim did with the reducer corrector, you'll be undersampling. So this means you'll not have enough pixels to get all the details that you could get with other sensor with smaller pixels. Using astronomy tools and Stellarium, you can find if you need a reducer corrector or not to get the best resolution. Let's go in Stellarium, and I do want to show you the field of view of the ZWO camera compared with my Nikon D7200 crop sensor and with the full frame camera D750. We have here the field of view for my Nikon D7200. Here also you can see the dark seconds per pixels. It's here 1.34. Let's see now the full frame Nikon D750. You can see the Whirlpool Galaxy, it is smaller in the field of view. And let's see also with my ZWO120 monochrome camera. We have this field of view, but only 1.2 megapixels. So cropped will be similar with my Nikon D7200 camera. And here we have the also the resolutions arc seconds per pixel. We have 1.29 arc seconds per pixel. So my ZWO camera has the best resolution. Now I do want to show you a few moments how I photographed the Whirlpool Galaxy with my ZWO camera and to show you the results. I had only 25 minutes integration time. The moon was up on the sky, about 60% illumination. So I did have also some gradients in the image, but I did manage to get a nice result for 25 minutes integration. So here we have only 25 minutes instead of 90 minutes. We are now in Photoshop, and let's make a fast comparison between the three images. I have here the image with ZWO camera. The exposure time was much shorter, 30 seconds. So I selected gain 80, that it seems to be too much for 30 second exposures. So we have here M51 with Nikon D7200. Much better, low noise. Here on the image that Jim sent me, he took the images at ISO 800, so even less noise here, but also less details than in the one that I used the Nikon. And here I do have color version with more noise than the monochrome, and another one here. So you can edit in Photoshop even if it's monochrome to get a color image with Whirlpool Galaxy. This was my result with the ZWO camera, but you can do much better if you'll have more integration time, longer exposures and lower gain. It has a much smaller sensor than a DSLR, 1/3 inch sensor. And also the field of view, it is very narrow. To be able to capture galaxies like the Whirlpool Galaxy, you really need to have a very accurate go-to. And I was very pleased of the results that I had using my Skywatcher EQM 35 Pro. Overall, I'm happy with the result in 25 minutes total integration. So, what are the conclusions? Using different cameras, you'll have also different results on galaxies, but also on nebulas. Full frame, it has a big advantage over crop sensor because it has bigger pixels and you'll get more light. And because of this, you'll have less image noise, better dynamic range. And on deep sky objects that look very small in the field of view, like the Whirlpool Galaxy or other smaller galaxies, you'll have a disadvantage because you'll have bigger pixels and you'll be undersampling using a small focal length telescope. So comparing the images with the Nikon D7200 crop sensor with the full frame, I managed to get more details on the image with the Nikon D7200. So in this case for galaxies, the crop sensor camera did perform better. Recently I made 1000 subscribers and I do want to thank you all that subscribed to my channel, liked my videos and enjoyed watching them. Thank you also for the beautiful comments. I'll see you soon in more astrophotography videos, reviews and tutorials. And I wish you a clear sky and thank you again for subscribing to my channel. And if you did not subscribe already, please do so you'll be able to see my future content and more astrophotography videos.